Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of RAS Consulting, Join the Dots podcast series. In this episode, I, Aditya Bell, will be joined by Sakshi Seni, who is one of our resident experts in the consulting group. Sakshi is going to walk us through the history of pharmaceuticals innovations and how they have impacted us as a global society. Before moving on to today's discussion, may I request every one of you to please subscribe to our channel on YouTube and other podcasting platforms, and also send us your comments, your likes, dislikes, and that will also that helps us to produce good content. We will start today's episode with a quick history of medicine and medical practices that predated the era of empirical medicine. We will then outline the major pharmaceutical breakthroughs since 1900 and how each of them has impacted our society, our lives personally too. And finally, and perhaps in the next episode, we're going to talk about how the future of pharmaceutical innovations is likely to unfold as we see it. So let's get started. Welcome, Sakshi.
Thank you, Aditya. A balcony's view of pharmaceutical innovations is a very exciting topic, and I'm really glad to be here.
Great. So Sakshi, let's dive straight into the topic. However, before we do that, perhaps you can give us some view of the state of the medicine before 1900. How would you characterize it?
Yeah. So if we go back in time, in earlier days, not much was known about the cause of the disease. So, like, for example, we take the Middle Ages, 476 to 1450 AD. So most doctors that time believed in the Greek theory from Galen, which was you become ill when the four humors, which are phlegm, black bile, yellow bile, blood, they become unbalanced. Yet the treatment practices at that time were not designed to restore any of this balance. So if you move fast forward to 17th century, William Harvey in 1628 discovered the blood circulation, and Anton van Leeuwenhoek's observation was on the bacteria in 1683. That would actually qualify as the first major breakthroughs of the early modern era. However, despite these breakthroughs, doctors still did not know at the time that germs caused the diseases. So we fast forwarding to like the middle of the 19th century, so they still believe that there is miasma, which is a poisonous vapor, which was considered as the main reason for diseases, which was like cholera, plague, and etc. So then eventually, it was in 1864, Louis Pasteur actually proved that the germs cause disease. And that's how the germ theory came into existence by the late 19th century.
Interesting. So it seems that the origins of the modern medicine as an industry, as a practice that we understand today, really started in the second half of the 19th century.
Yes, yes. In fact, 19th century saw many advances. For example, this was the age when the first use of anesthetics happened. Then this was also the time when the first vaccines were introduced. And also this is an interesting thing. This was also the time when the first woman, Elizabeth Blackwell of the US, was actually awarded a medical degree.
Wow, very nice. That's interesting to know. So let me jump ahead a bit. Which pharmaceutical innovation in the last 120 years, which innovations in the last 120 years stand out in your mind and why?
Well, if you go back last 120 years, if I think of all the innovations, discovery of vaccines stand out the most. To me, it is because firstly, it led to saving millions of lives. For example, if you take smallpox, which has now been successfully eradicated from this world. I mean, this would not be an exaggeration to say that more than 1 billion lives have been saved using these different vaccines over the last 120 years.
1 billion lives. That's a very large number. And it's the... just to put that into some kind of a quantitative visual in one's mind itself is mind-boggling.
Yeah.
And the interesting part of this is that we take vaccines for granted. We forget that as a technology, it has really come into existence in the last 120, 130 years or so. Mm-hmm. Let's carry the discussion further. Which other medical innovations stand out in your mind?
The history of pharmaceutical innovations is so long that it cannot be covered in one episode. But just for today, I will list out the ones which I think, in my view, have fundamentally shaped today's treatment protocols. Start with 1897, when aspirin became the first synthetic pharmaceutical. It was actually developed to alleviate the symptoms of rheumatism. And at the time of its discovery, it was generally assumed that the aspirin eased pain by operating on the central nervous system. But obviously, now today we know that its applications go well beyond pain relief. And it can also be used to combat inflammation, which is linked to heart diseases and a variety of cancers. It can even help in treating heart attacks and has also shown some utility in preventing strokes. So if we put an estimate, for example, the use of aspirin alone, it has saved over 1 million lives. Now, if we're moving on ahead, if we come to 1922, this was the time when the insulin was invented. So if we go back in 1922, diabetes used to be known as a sugar sickness disease. The only treatment was to starve the patients. And this starvation method led to wasting away of the patients, which ultimately led to their deaths.
Right.
Today, diabetes is generally a well-managed with insulin, in addition to a very healthy lifestyle. In fact, you would be actually surprised to believe that the insulin discovery is often believed to have paved the way for future hormone replacement therapies. We now also know that diabetes increases the risk of stroke, heart failure, and death. So if I put a rough estimate, so the insulin use itself actually saved approximately 15 million lives cumulatively over the time.
Wow.
Yeah, so now if I can move back, if I can recall back, so this is, there would be the year 1942. This was the time when penicillin, which was the world's first antibiotic, was introduced to us. So if so penicillin being the very first antibiotic itself led to saving of 80 million to 200 million. And if you really think about that, it is like without its discovery and its implementation, if you look at today's world population, 75% of the people would not be alive because their ancestors would have been succumbed to infections. So we know that the penicillin now has been used to treat a plethora of conditions such as pneumonia, scarlet fever, as well as eye, skin, ear, and throat infections.
Right.
It's very wide. So now if we move back, then there comes the year 1951. So this was the year when clofazimine, which was the world's first official antipsychotic drug, which that was introduced. So its discovery and use actually were a turning point in the history of psychiatry. Not only this drug was a huge success, but over 10 years later, it was seen that it was used around 50 million people across the globe. So clofazimine, actually, we know that it has now paved the way for future generations of anxiety and depression drugs, and it's actually led to heralding the psychopharmacological revolution.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So there was then, in the year 1956, that another breakthrough happened. This time, methotrexate became the first drug to cure a rare cancer. So over the next decades, as we know, there were advances in chemotherapy were made, and numerous drugs with different mechanism of actions actually led to dramatic improvements in patient survival and led to decline in the cancer-related deaths. So there was then there was an interesting period, which was between 1960 to 1980s. This 20-year period saw a major advance in the field of women's health. So during this time, FDA approved first oral birth control pill. So, and what this pill did, it helped to manage some of the medical conditions like PCOS, endometriosis, acne, or severe menstrual cramps in women. This pill also had a significant social influence. It improved women's reproductive health, significantly reduced child mortality, and most importantly, freed women to pursue their goals and aspirations without the burden of having a pregnancy.
It's interesting how the medical technology and feminism sort of go hand in hand in many ways.
Yeah.
A lot of these issues used to be constraints, but not anymore.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there was, then moving ahead in the year 1985. Yes, this was a time, this begins the era of cholesterol-lowering drugs called statins. heart patients today actually owe a lot to two breakthrough drugs, which is Lennoxin, which was actually digoxin, and there was also Lisix, which was furosemide, which was also known as low aqua. So digoxin, as you know, it helps in creating a more rhythmic heartbeat by increasing intracellular sodium concentration, thereby increasing the muscular strength of the heart. Whereas furosemide helps in decongesting the heart by increasing the excretion of sodium from the body via urine. There is also another known drug, which is Lipitor. It is the most widely known among statins as of today, and it has actually contributed significantly to reducing the morbidity and mortality associated with excess cholesterol in the blood.
Right.
Lipitor, it was actually developed by the Pfizer, if we see the time chart of the drug itself, it actually went on to become the best-selling drug of all the time.
That's true. It's I think its peak sale was somewhere around $14 billion, and that peak sale was maintained for over a period of I think almost a decade, but maybe a little less. So, which actually comes to your point that its total sales was somewhere around $125-$130 billion.
Yes, and then in the year 1987, this was the drug, this was actually the time when the first antiretroviral drug for HIV was launched. So the drug was zidovudine, which was also known as AZT, and it is actually one of the biggest breakthroughs in the fight against AIDS. When this drug is used in combination with other drugs, AZT was useful in helping the patients from succumbing to full-blown AIDS. So, if we do a rough estimate, the use of this drug actually led to prevention and has saved over 15 million lives. And now, the fast-forwarding to 1998, there came Viagra, the little blue pill, which was again launched by Pfizer. So, within the first year, the erectile dysfunction drug had racked up the sales of around 788 million within the very first year. And if you look at the drug itself, it has generated over 1 billion in sales every single year till it reached its peak sales of 2.1 billion in 2012.
Right.
Yeah. So, Viagra, as we know, it has revitalized the sex lives of millions of people. And
true.
It is not only a lifesaver, admittedly, but its users would actually argue that it certainly affected their quality of life.
Correct. And before Viagra, I think erectile dysfunction was not considered as a proper medical condition. And as funny as it may sound, but we do have to give credit to Pfizer for actually helping the world acknowledge that this is a serious condition.
Yes, that's true. And then again in the year, if we come to 1998, this was also the year when a new era in oncolytics was started with the launch of Herceptin, which was being the very first targeted monoclonal antibody.
Right.
It was used to treat breast cancer. Herceptin itself actually ushered in a wave of cancer treatments that were targeted towards a specific patient types. So during the first decade of the century, several noteworthy targeted cancer treatments were approved and brought to the market. For example, if we talk about EGFR protein targeting moieties such as erlotinib, gefitinib, cetuximab, and panitumumab, actually changed the treatment paradigm associated with non-small cell lung cancer. And if we talk about anti-angiogenesis drugs like bevacizumab, which was actually initially approved for non-small cell lung cancer, was also found to be helpful in colorectal, breast, and brain cancers. If I can actually summarize with the other targeted treatments like bortezomib and sorafenib, these were also the drugs which changed the treatment paradigm for mantle cell lymphoma and kidney cancers.
Mm-hmm.
And then let's move forward to the period of coming to the 21st century, to 2010 to 2020 decade. This actually decade turned out to be even more groundbreaking for the life science industry. So there were many noteworthy therapies that were launched during this time. For example, when we talk about immunotherapeutics, Provenge was the first to get launched in 2010, which was followed by Opdivo, Keytruda, and Tecentriq. So essentially what these drugs were doing, they were actually eliciting the body's own immune response to fight cancer cells. So, and we now know that each of this immunotherapeutic drug has been approved now for multiple cancers. Moving on, then there were gene therapies where it was Chimera, which was developed by Novartis, and then there was Yescarta, which was developed by Kite Pharma. And both of these drugs were actually brought to the market to treat different types of lymphomas.
Right.
Now, if you talk about outside of cancer, there is a company called the Spark Therapeutics, which developed and launched a drug called Lixterna, which treated a very rare inherited disease, which was retinal dystrophy. So what this disease does, it is a kind of blindness, which would cause a rare genetic disorder of the retina. So till now, whatever the drugs I have talked about, actually they are targeting some of the other proteins itself. Now, there is a class of drugs which is RNA interference-based drugs. So what these drugs do, they target the mechanism of making proteins. So if you talk about that, this class of drugs, the medicine which immediately comes to my mind is Onpattro, which is targets a double-stranded small RNA that interferes in the protein production process of dysfunctional transthyretin gene. What Onpattro does is, it actually is used, it targets a specific RNA protein, which is transthyretin, which actually leads to amyloidosis. Then there were other drugs like Truvada, which was launched for HIV in 2012. Then there was Ocrelivis, again in the same year, launched for multiple sclerosis. And then there was Zadato, which was used to treat Parkinson's disease. All these, I think, were launched in time frame between 2015 to 2017. So what happened is these drugs led to an increase in the life expectancy of patients from, if you think, 2 to 3 years in the 1990s to several decades by 2010. Then lastly, there is also one drug which was in recently in 2019, Radicava, which was launched for amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. This is important because till today, this is the only approved drug which gave patients the chance to slow the progression of the disease and improve their ability to carry out the day-to-day tasks like eating, speaking, etc.
This is quite interesting. I must say that this is also a lot of credit goes to the amount of hard work and years of research that have gone into making each of these drugs, into understanding the disease pathology, designing medications to be able to target the right molecular villains of the disease, and then to be able to show the kind of effect that either in terms of life expectancy or quality of life or just functional independence and regaining functional independence and autonomy. You touched upon a point regarding life expectancy. So maybe we can take a few minutes to talk a little bit about the actual impact on human life. Maybe you can throw some light on that.
Yeah. Well, if you look at this, life expectancy has risen significantly over the last century. So, for example, if you take since 1900s, the global average life expectancy has actually now doubled. Round about to close to 73 years when by 2019, if we consider. Mostly, this is medical innovations such as vaccines, antibiotics, targeted medicines, and then there are also improvements in the public health interventions like improvement in public sanitation. All this contributed to bring the change in this life expectancy. Now, if we were to look at some of the matrices, for example, pasteurization. it alone saved around 250 million lives. And then there was if you look at antibiotics, again, it contributed to saving close to 200 million lives. While vaccines alone saved 1 billion lives. I think that if we were to compare the 1900s with 2010s, what we are seeing is there are fewer and fewer people are dying at a very young age. So for example, if we look at the age at which the people die, has now changed significantly since the 1990s. So now fewer people are dying at a very young age. For example, in 1990, nearly one quarter of all deaths globally were in children which were younger than 5. So in 2019, this has actually declined to just under 9%. In contrast, what we are seeing is the share of deaths in over 70s age bracket has increased from a third to half of all the deaths over this period. At a very global level, what we are seeing is collective death rates across all ages have been in steady decline. Now, what this shows is that the global health has improved considerably over the course of the last generation. Now, to put our discussion into perspective, with all the scientific advancements, innovations, medical and technological breakthroughs, life expectancy is expected to further increase from 70 years to close to 78 years by 2050.
It's very interesting that you actually touched upon the fact that our life expectancy is increasing. So the natural question that comes is, what innovations do you foresee which will actually contribute to prolonging that life?
This is a great question. But to describe the next frontiers, it actually requires another discussion. Now, let me get back to you on this in our next episode.
Okay. Well, thank you, Sakshi. That is actually a fantastic, wonderful journey of the history of pharmacological innovations. And I do think these kind of conversations are needed for the general society to actually understand how pharmaceutical industry has contributed to the quality of our society, as well by not just prolonging life, but also improving our health in general. I'm sure that the full list is very long of the innovations, and we could probably spend multiple episodes in discussing all that has been invented and brought to market in the last 100 years. However, we'll leave it at a high level at the moment. For viewers and listeners, please remember to subscribe to our channel once again and give us comments, give us your feedback, because that definitely helps us sharpen the content. So, Sakshi, with that, I will take your leave, because we do anticipate we'll be having a conversation soon about some of the pharmacological innovations that we foresee coming up in the next few years. Thank you so much.
Bye.
And for the viewers, till next time. Have a nice day. Bye.